Thanks to all of you for being here with us on behalf of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation. And first of all, I just want to thank the President of the European Academy of Religion, and of course, this Professor Jocelyn Cesari, and of course, the Secretary General of the Academy, Francesca Cadetto. And a special thank to all of you and my fellow co-panelists, and to Alberto Melloni, the secretary of the Foundation for Religious Science, so, who actually started this whole project and has been instrumental in actually allowing all of us being here for what has become now the main event in Europe concerning the study, research, exchange of practice and opinion and ideas about religious sciences. This was a gamble that Alberto started to play 4 years ago, and it has been very successful. And I have actually to thank him also on behalf of the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation for involving us since the beginning. But just before I say something about the topic and, of course, about the coming days of discussion that will be here at the Academy from the perspective of a diplomat and a practitioner in foreign policy. Of course, I try to answer to a very basic question that has to do with the fact, why the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and International Cooperation is involved in such a project. And for this, I must say, and the question, what diplomacy has to do with religion, especially considering Italy as a secular state since the start. And first of all, to understand this, especially for our foreign friends, it is to do a little bit with the Italian history. And I wouldn't, perhaps I would dare to go as far as saying that religion and interest for religious affairs is embedded in the DNA of Italian diplomacy and Italian foreign policy. And the historical reasons are there, of course. Italy, the unification of Italy was also a compromise, a negotiation between the creation of a state and the fact that the Holy Seat, Rome, the city of Rome, was considered to be the capital of Italy since the start of Risorgimento, of the Italian independent war. And then all the negotiation that went for the participation of the Catholics to the Italian political life with the Patto Gentiloni and afterwards with the Concordato. But then I would also say with the importance, in any case, of religious association in the life of the Italian Republic. So to be an Italian diplomat, it means from the start having a special attention to the importance of the religious factor in any society. And this is, I would say, the basic explanation for which, you know, one of the big discussion in diplomacy and in the training of diplomats has to do with what is called religious literacy, which is actually a very important topic. But it's one of those topics that for Italian is a sort of given for granted. Most of our diplomats are actually trained to think in terms of understanding as much as possible the complexity of the society they live in. And in this understanding the complexity, there is a first reflex of the Italian diplomat in trying to understand how society basically works, the importance of religion and religious factors. But I will come back on this issue just at the end. I just want to get rid of the basics of some of the of what the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs is doing in terms of the impact of religion on our foreign policy and the importance of religion in our foreign policy. And I would just say that there are five, six, but just to name a few of them, there are five or six projects and subjects that to which we dedicate the utmost importance. The first one is, of course, protection of religious minorities. And this is something that we grant the maximum importance to promotion and protection of freedom of religion and belief, and to the rights of ethnic and religious minority. And over the last years, we actually contributed to bring the attention of the international community to these issues. I just don't want to go through all the programs that we had, but just to quote something, Italy has just been appointed in the Human Rights Council of the United Nations for the years 2019-2021, and of course, in the program of the Italian presidency, you will note that first item and most important item is the fight versus xenophobia, and then protection of religious minorities, and then the moratorium on death penalty. And this is something that has very much to do to the sanctity of human life that is actually common to all religion. And of course, in this framework, we remember the initiative for the humanitarian corridors that actually was supported by the Italian Ministry of Foreign Affairs with the community of Sant'Egidio and with the evangelical churches that allowed actually to, as a response, it was conceived also as a response to a growing number of individuals dying in the Mediterranean Sea, and to allow through these corridors a safe and legal pathway to Europe for vulnerable refugees and asylum seekers coming from communities. And this actually has been also has become a sort of the concept of the protection of minorities and Christian minorities has become actually a program that has been actually written down in our budget law for having a specific program on the protection of the Christian minorities. And then I want to go along on the Italian presidency of the OSCE, in which we actually conceived several events and sensibilization programs and conferences about the promotion of freedom of religion and belief, protection of minorities, fight against antisemitism, and fight against xenophobia and discrimination based on ground of religion. And also during the final conference in Milan, we actually had a specific event which was dedicated especially to interreligious dialogue and what we call the next step of interreligious dialogue, which has to do with interreligious engagement. And I will come a little bit more on this concept, which is very dear to us. And then we have a program lasted for the past 10 years, and we will have a seminar during the European Academy of Religion for the second time, dedicated especially to the interrelationship between religion and foreign affairs. And this is a program that has lasted, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs has started this 10 years ago. And it has changed, it has morphed a lot. It has become something different. And the new wave of this program is very much focusing also on the responsibility and the responsibility of religious leader, interreligious engagement, and the collaboration between religious authorities and the government. And finally, of course, European Academy of Religion. Since for the past 3 years, we have been supporting the European Academy of Religion, and we strongly believe that the foundation of the European Academy of Religion has actually created a new space for a political discourse about religion in Europe, and that it is something that was deeply needed and that we will continue to support as much as we can. I will come close to the conclusion. Before, I just spoke about the historical reason and what I called the DNA of interest and attention to religious factors and to the religious phenomenon in Italian foreign policy. And I was rereading, actually, I am rereading now, Eric Hobsbawm's The Age of Extremes, and which is a fundamental book in Italian. The Italian title, according to me, is much better. Is actually Il Secolo Breve. And It's a fascinating book, one of the masterpieces of contemporary history. And if you go through the book, you don't see any, almost any reference to religion in the whole book. The whole history of the 20th century is as religion was not an important factor and was something that was not decisive to the. And what is interesting, actually, that at the end of the book, Hobsbawm come back with something different. He starts to say in the final chapter, it starts to observe the importance of religion. He's very skeptical. He keeps himself skeptical, but he actually notices that something is happening. He doesn't consider that it will be important, but he feels the need to note it down. And this is something that is extremely interesting, because if you consider that in the 20th century you had phenomena like, and I will just quote a couple of them, like, for instance, the birth of Christian fundamentalism and the famous trial about in the South, in which for the first time you spoke of Christian fundamentalism, or a phenomenon like the Muslim Brotherhood, or a phenomenon like the Hindutva, in which you can really see that actually this, the importance of religion and the importance of religion in actually shaping the society and afterwards politics was still there. But then even a great historian like Hobsbawm couldn't see this. But now it's very clear to us that the what we can call the resurgence of religion and the strength of religion in politics and society, it is evident to all of us. And events of the past 20, 25 years have actually consolidated this. So there is something right in what in the skepticism of Hobsbawm, in the sense that when we speak of religious conflicts, we understand, and of the great religious conflicts and tension that we see now in the international order, we see that most of the time these conflicts and tension are actually political or geopolitical or fight for hegemony. For instance, Shia versus Sunni, Saudi Arabia versus Iran. And the conflicts are actually mostly between states or communities, in which what you see is more geopolitical and economic conflicts. Nevertheless, the religious clock is there. It disguises reality. Sometimes it even changes reality and transforms the conflict in something different. So, and I come to the conclusion, there are some concepts which are very dear to us that could actually help frame the better understanding of the interrelationship between religion and foreign policy that could help us as practitioner or interpreter to a better understanding of this relationship. The first one is a situational awareness, and it is our ability to understand the environment in which we operate and, of course, to anticipate changes. And this requires knowledge of history, culture, social fabrics, politics, economy, and of all the country where we need to operate. And, of course, the knowledge of religion and of the different traditions within this society and state is essential. And then, of course, I was a bit dismissive about religious literacy from an Italian point of view, but this is a basic issue which is very important for all diplomats working everywhere. They must have a basic knowledge of categories and concepts related to religion. And the religious literacy is essential not only, of course, for practitioners of foreign policy, but I would say also for all of us on the domestic front. All of us in Europe, we have to cope with the religious minority, with their expectations and problems, and with the needs that all these expectations and concerns have and the importance they have within the society. And finally, religious literacy is an essential component of what is the immaterial infrastructures upholding our system. And that this immaterial infrastructure is what keeps the society and the polity together. And finally, of course, and this is a concept that we developed and to which we will dedicate the seminar that we will have on the 6th, on the 7th, in the framework of the Academy of Religion, which will be dedicated to the concept and the idea of interreligious engagement. And so the common responsibility of religious and political leader and the religious leader, not only as recipient of paradigms and direction, but partners in building long-term strategies to foster pluralism. And now I really conclude with the quotation, which has been abused somehow, but it is essential also to understand the way in which Italian foreign policy is trying to frame these years and the years to come. And the quotation is from Gramsci. It's very, very abused. And the concept that there are very bad, I would say, in looking at the quotation, the translation in English of the quotation from Gramsci, I've seen very bad translation. But it is more or less something like that. The old world is dying. The new world is not yet born, and we live in an age of, he speaks of interregnum, but we live in an age of transition in which you can have any kind of morbid phenomena. The intuition of Gramsci has to do with, of course, with his own age and the coming of fascism, etc., but it has to do with the concept of crisis. And the situation in which we live, the transition of a crisis, that is very much to do with what we are living now. And just to conclude, this is a moment in which the crisis is not only in our societies, in our politics, but it's a general crisis of a world order who is not yet there, and the new order has yet to be built. And this is the moment in which we need all the knowledge we can have, and in which the basic concept is complexity and our ability to educate our society to complexity. And the fact that the world is much more complicated and complex, but also much more rich and beautiful than sometimes they try to teach to us. So thank you very much.